Good morning and welcome to Rose Red Homestead. Because it's winter time and a good time to think about food storage, emergency storage, preparation for what could be, that's why we are going to be getting the skinny on dietary fats today. So we'll talk about their story and how they are divided up into categories. And then we will talk a little bit about the characteristics of each of those categories. And especially we want to talk about how to store fats for the longest time possible. So we'll get right to it as soon as we come back. One of the most important things about dietary fats is that they are essential for our life. Some our bodies make for itself, others we have to provide through diet, and we'll go through all of that today. Fats are a source of energy, translation calories, so they are also really good to store long term, and we'll again get into that when we talk about long-term storage toward the end of the video. And because fats digest slowly, when they're eaten along with carbohydrates, it mitigates the effects of the carbs so that we don't have a sudden sugar crash. Things are digested much slower. We're going to start with something very, very important, and I'm going to start with it because of its importance, and that is we want to completely stay away from partially hydrogenated. That word in the ingredients list means that the product contains trans fat, and trans fat is bad for us. It has been linked with heart disease, and we need to stay completely away from partially hydrogenated oils, mostly soybean oil. And it results in kind of a funny looking molecule. That's why it's called trans fat, and it has been linked with heart disease. And the FDA has now regulated that the amount of trans fat and the ingredient partially hydrogenated oil has to be on the product labels. So stay away from this, it is not good for us. So I have all the other ones laid out right here, and they are grouped according to how they are classified. So right here we have the saturated fats, and over here are the unsaturated fats. And they are subdivided and subdivided. This is a pretty tight group right over here, the saturated fats. Saturated fats have really tight bonds, and they are solid at room temperature. Most of these are animal fats, except for, this is coconut oil and palm oil, which I do not have an example of. But those two come from plants, and they are saturated because they are solid at room temperature. But we know that butter and cheese, and here's lard and shortening, all of these are saturated fats. So some of the characteristics of these are, it's very interesting. The butter is about 80% of fat. And then the other 20% is some protein and some milk solids. If we remove the protein and milk solids through a process of clarifying butter, which we have a video on, then we can produce ghee. Ghee has a really long shelf life. And so ghee is 100% fat without the milk solids. So people that have allergies to milk and can't drink regular dairy milk, this is okay for them because the milk solids have been removed from it. So, and then of course cheese, and this is string cheese. This is one of our favorites, but cheese also. Now, if we were just going to lump everything into a broad category, we could say that these are probably not as good for the human body as these are. But I want you to pay attention to the fact that I'm very well aware that people's opinions of fats are very strong. And a lot of people are very opinionated on about fats. I'm a pretty much middle of the road. I base my choices on what I know to be the latest research, but I can tell you that research has flip-flopped back and forth on fats my whole entire life. And so the latest and greatest information about fats may completely change what we knew to be true 10 years ago. For instance, lard. I grew up in a household where we stayed completely away from lard because it was supposed to be so bad. Now lard, you may know, is rendered pig fat. If you've ever eaten bacon and saved the fat afterward, that is a form of lard. It is rendered pig fat. Now, you can buy fresh lard, which is not shelf stable. This is shelf stable because it has some additives and it will last much longer than fresh. And we'll talk about storage issues on all of these in just a bit. But the thing about lard is that it's a middle of the road fat. It is no longer considered such a huge no-no and a fat to avoid as it was at one time. So it's come back into favor. And the only time that I have ever used lard is when I make tamales. And boy, does it ever make great tamales. Over here on the unsaturated side, these are mostly, but not all, plant-based. And we have monounsaturated and polyunsaturated in the unsaturated category. So it's kind of split into these two. So we're going to start let's start over here with olive oil. So olive oil is a monounsaturated fat. And the label on the back of this olive oil says saturated fat, 1.6 grams, trans fat, 0, polyunsaturated, 1.9, monounsaturated, 10 grams. And so these are categorized by the greatest amount of which kind of fat. So this has all kinds of fat except no trans fat, but it has mostly right here in the monounsaturated. This is flaxseed. So seeds and nuts and avocados are here. These are walnuts. And so this is the mono. This is the polyunsaturated. So this is polyunsaturated, but it's the omega-3s. Now omega-3s, these are the ones that are really necessary for us to get from our diet because we don't make these in our bodies. And so these have to come from our diet. So what do we eat to give us the omega-3s? Fatty fish, this is salmon. In fact, this salmon was canned the middle of August of 2019. So this is a year and a half old. We should probably start eating these. Probably this salmon would last about 3 years. I would be very comfortable with this for 3 years. So salmon is really, really good for us with the omega-3s in it. If you don't have salmon or canned salmon yourself, home can it, then it probably would be really good to store some canned salmon. And then of course, tuna. Now you can look at the expiration date on the bottom of prepared foods. Well, if I would turn it right side up. Oh, this expired December 26th, just recently in 2020. So this tuna has expired. So do I throw it away? Oh, absolutely not. Because the wording says best used by. And they've changed that wording because it used to be expired on such a date and people would start throwing it away. But are you telling me that one day it's good and then the next day on the day it's expired, it's no longer good? Ha, that doesn't even make any sense. And so we'll keep these. We have several more. We're working on a case of these that we have out in our food storage. So this is also a really good source of omega-3. And then these are sunflower seeds. This is another good choice for omega-3s. Then with omega-6s, and I don't have very many of these. In fact, I just bought this at the store. I have, this is canola oil, and it's mostly the vegetable oils, the omega-6s. And in today's culture, we really don't need to worry about too much about the omega-6s because they're just in our diet all the time. Anything that we buy at the store in terms of baked goods or that sort of thing has plenty of omega-6. They're in carbohydrates and so that's why I bought just a little bottle, because I don't use a lot of this. I use olive oil for most of our things. Let's talk for a minute about why it's important to know how to store fats. First of all, right now we are living through a huge disruption, one of the biggest disruptions that globally we've faced in 100 years, and that is, of course, the COVID pandemic. And so we all are aware firsthand of how that has disrupted our supply lines, even our food supply lines. Some places still have not recovered. I can't find canning jars anywhere locally. And when I try to go find them online, they're about three or four times as expensive as they were a year ago. And so disruptions happen. And when that occurs, we never know how long the duration of such a disruption is going to be. And so there are some of us who like to have things on hand that in case the whole society shuts down for a little while, we and our families can still survive. The type of foods that we store are generally grains and legumes and rice. Well, now think about that. Right now, when we have everything available pretty much in the grocery stores, we don't need to worry so much about which fats that we have, because we can just run to the store and get some. But if it ever happens that we can't do that, what if we had to just live on what we had for 3 months or 6 months or longer? And fats are a very necessary part, and not only that, the type of food that many of us may be storing don't include a lot of fats the way we do now. We can't run down to the bakery and pick up a bag of dinner rolls or whatever. Anything that we do will have to come from our own reserves and creativity. And so having fats on hand is really important. So when we think about these different types of fats, with olive oil, for instance, with any kind of oil really, the big enemy to all of these fats is heat, oxygen, light. And so we want to pick storage containers that will keep out those things as much as possible. So olive oil in dark glass is the best way to store it. And olive oil will keep for 2 to 3 years. So if it's unopened, once we open it, we need to use it fairly quickly. And then keep that cap on it in between times. Don't leave the cap off while we're measuring ingredients or something else. Now for nuts and seeds, storing larger quantities of these is probably a really good idea, but they don't keep for a really long time. And so storing these in the refrigerator or in the freezer, if that's possible, is the best possible way to store these for long term. And we can do that for up to 6 months to a year with these type of things. And of course, avocados, even though they are pretty high in monounsaturated, no way to do these. We're just lucky to get these fresh when we can. Okay, now for the polyunsaturated, same thing with seeds in the refrigerator. We can either buy these already canned or we can can these themselves. And the shelf life on these, even though it's pretty much agreed upon by manufacturers, is about a year. These keep much longer than a year. I, for instance, with the salmon, will keep this for 3 or 4 years and it will be just fine. With the omega-6 oils, these go rancid. And when I say rancid, that is when the oil interacts with oxygen. You all know what rancidity is. It gives a bad taste, it gives a bad smell, it's yellowish. I wonder why these oils are yellow. But anyway, these go rancid fairly quickly, 6 months to a year. So really there is no way to adequately store these for 4 or 5 years. You just need to rotate. So figure out how much you're going to use in a year, get a year's supply, and then rotate through that supply. Over here, we are a little bit more lucky because some of these have a shelf life that is a little bit longer. With lard, again, lard, even though it is shelf stable, if you buy it not fresh, if you buy it so that this shelf stabilized lard, you can get this in great big tubs, 10-pound tubs, and it's fairly, it is in the fair category of long-term storage. If I were to buy a big supply of lard in one of those great big buckets, I would keep it in my freezer if I have space, and then it would last for 3 years. But otherwise, if it's just on the shelf, and we want to keep the air away from it, we want to keep heat away from it, and so 6 months, a year max on this. We get butter on sale all the time, and we store it in the freezer. And as often as possible, I will mix up from this butter ghee, because this is how we store our butter, not like this, but like this. And the wonderful thing about ghee is that we can keep it in the cupboard. It does not have to be refrigerated. And because it is pure fat, it will keep at room temperature for a long, long time. Some people say indefinitely. I have ghee that I have done well over a year ago, and it is still as good as the day that I made it. And so this is really one of our go-to fats that we have stored. With coconut oil, this also has a pretty long shelf life. So this is stored in plastic, which is not as good as glass, but we keep it airtight. This is an unopened one. I have an opened one that's now about down to here, and I will use one of these about every 6 months. So I keep about 3 of these on hand in our backup shelf because I know that it will last that long. Cheese, of course, is a whole different topic. You can freeze this and keep it for a long time. There are some people who can cheese. I don't can cheese. That brings us to Crisco. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about Crisco. This was what my mother used, and so I grew up with it, and I learned to cook with it, and I love it. This is what I make my pie crust with butter for the fat part of pie crust. So Crisco has always been my go-to until I learned about trans fat, because Crisco was full of trans fat for years, and then it got a really bad review and people quit buying it. Well, they got smart, and now you can read the label on the back of the Crisco can. So it is saturated fat, 3.5 grams, trans fat, 0, polyunsaturated fat, 6 grams, monosaturated fat, 2 grams. Okay, so this is still classified as a saturated fat because it is solid at room temperature. I come down here and read the ingredients list. Soybean oil, fully hydrogenated palm oil. Notice that it is not partially hydrogenated. They want to be sure that their former customers who left them, as I did, now know that Crisco no longer has any trans fat because they fully hydrogenate the oil that makes this much more shelf stable, turns it white, and the consistency that it has. However, it is stored in these cardboard cartons. This used to be stored in a metal can, and boy, they would be perfect for long-term storage. I don't keep them in a cardboard can because heat, oxygen, sunlight. And so these are really not super airtight, even though they would like you to believe that. I put it in jars, and I'm going to show you how to do that and how we store it in just a moment, but I'm going to clear some things out of the way. I'll be right back. It seems a little silly to think about putting Crisco in a jar, but that's how to keep it best. So, and it's a little bit messy, so be prepared for that. This is just a clean jar, and it's wide mouth. I most definitely want wide mouth. And then with each time, I stomp it down as much as possible. I know that some people say just warm it slightly so that it's liquid and then put it in the jar. I would not do that at all because heat is one of the major enemies to this fat. And so I will tolerate a few little air bubbles rather than heating it. Wiping the rims as much as possible, and no need to leave any headspace. Then, last of all, I'm just going to vacuum seal it. Remove as much air and oxygen as possible. And it always manages to squish a little bit out. I don't know where it finds it, but it does. And then I will label it like this one, Crisco with a date. And then when I'm ready to take these out to our storage area, I'm going to put them down inside a cardboard box to where they will be completely in the dark. And these will keep this way for 3 to 5 years. And so that's why I do this to Crisco. This will guarantee us that we will have a good supply of fat regardless of what happens. Thanks for joining us. I hope this information is useful to you. Happy canning, happy preparing for emergencies, and we will see you at our next video.